Charlie was persistent. Come on, A, we gotta get up there. Let's get this money. Stop being paranoid. He should have went with his first mind. Due to so many conflicting stories, this has been one of the most difficult projects to get into. AZ has his versions of how everything happened. Alpo has his versions of how everything happened. Gangsta Lou has his versions of how everything happened. And there's many other Harlem cats who speak differently about what happened during that era. Now, before you try to crucify me in the comments, like some of you did in parts 1, 2, and 3, this information that I'm giving you right here, right now, comes directly from his autobiography. This is his book, his own autobiography. I know in a recent interview that he had with Vlad, many of these accounts were switched up. Now let's get back to it. Joanne wasn't really his aunt. She was just a good friend of the family. She used to put apartments, cars, and many other things in her name. And so he felt like it was only right to call her his aunt. They climbed up the stairs to Joanne's. Once they got to the door, they knocked, the door swung open, and somebody holding a Uzi, wearing a stocking cap, grabbed him and pulled him to the apartment. Once AZ was inside, he recognized one of the men, and he said, Kevin Clark, is that you? What are you doing? Kevin said, what did it look like? And don't say my name again, or you dead. One of the men pulled a safe from the bedroom onto the living room floor. Kevin told him to take the other people into the next room. Open the safe. Open the safe before I kill you. AZ said, yo, Kev, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? He hit AZ in the face with the gun hard above his eye. Now his whole face was covered in blood. Blood was pouring into his eyes. I told you not to say my name again. Open up the safe before I kill you. You see, Kevin Clark was this cat who dated AZ's sister back in the day. Kevin used to work at this grocery store with this old-timer named Mr. Vincent, who used to sell coke in the back of his store. To make a long story short, Mr. Vincent was found dead in his apartment and cut into pieces and stuffed inside of an old trunk. Kevin started freebasing at the time real bad. You know, a crackhead to do anything for money. After Mr. Vincent's death, Kevin went into hiding. One day, Kevin told AZ's sister that he wanted to speak to him. Now see, around this time, AZ wasn't in the game yet. He was still just a kid.
He always got his return when he wanted it.
So AZ went to go see him. AZ went to his crib, and Kevin put a gun into his face and started frisking him. Kevin, high off his mind, his eyes was as big as 50 cent pieces and red like fire. Yo, AZ, I need you to do me a big favor, man. I need you to give this to your man Rich and tell him to move it for me. He handed AZ a huge bag full of coke, about half a kilo. He wanted to tell him no, but he seen Kevin standing there coked out with a loaded gun. He wised up and complied to whatever he was talking about. Kevin warned AZ not to cross him as he pointed the gun to his head. Do this for me, man. You gotta do this for me. Don't let me down. I need your help. AZ said, all right, Kev, I got you. AZ took the dope and gave it to his sister and said, I'm not dealing with that dude, Kevin. He's crazy. And you crazy for messing with that cat. You're gonna get yourself killed. She eventually gave the coke back to Kevin. Just days later, Kevin fell asleep riding on the train with two guns on him and ended up getting booked. Police caught him. He was found guilty on gun and drug possession and ended up doing 6 years. He was released from prison in February 1987. So by the time Kevin got out, AZ was the man. Now, when Kevin got out of the joint, he connected with AZ again. AZ gave him a brand new drop top Saab, gave him a block that moved about a brick a week, took him shopping, and put $15,000 in his pocket. All he had to do was fall back, relax, and stack his money.
My sister's boyfriend at the time, she was fucking with this cat, and he went to jail. So when he came home, you know, he stepped to me, "What's good, man? I hear you doing." "Yeah, no problem. What's good? But I know you, you know, you're just coming home. I'm not gonna put you in the game, cause gave him some money. I think I gave him like $15,000 cash. Took him to the garage. What car you want?" He took the Saab convertible. "Okay, take that. You feel me? You good, right?" Then I gave him a cat that was moving a bird a week,
okay,
a block. I said, "Yo, I'm gonna make sure you good with him." But in his thoughts, with his intentions is, he looked maybe looking at it from a whole different perspective.
Yeah.
Like, damn, if he set me up like this, how much he got?
Okay.
You understand? And who knows what he was telling his homies while he was locked up in jail. You feel me? In jail is a whole nother world.
Yeah.
He might have been like, "Yo, when we get home, we gonna get this nigga."
Yeah.
I don't know. But when you come home, I could fix that thought. Here.
But see, greed can alter your state of mind. He put $15,000 into this man's pocket, gave him a block that was moving a brick a week, gave him a brand new car, took him shopping, and he still robbed AZ. Now, fast forward to August 20th, 1987. Here's Kevin standing over AZ, pointing a gun into his face like a madman. "Open the safe, nigga. Open the safe now, or I'm gonna kill everybody up in here. Hurry up." That was the last thing AZ heard before he got hit in the head with the gun, causing blood to flow into his eyes. Shaking with fear and numb from the pain, he tried to respond. "Look, man, the blood is blinding me. I can't see. I don't even have no money in this safe anyway. Just let everybody go. I'll get you some money. They ain't got nothing to do with this." Stumbling around, he managed to clear some blood from his eyes by using his t-shirt. And what he saw took his breath away. Five people, including his aunt and his best friend, were tied up, handcuffed, laying face down while pleading for their lives. Now, Kevin was getting angrier because AZ couldn't open the safe. Blood was blinding AZ. And while he couldn't see, he started talking fast and coming up with a plan. Hopefully, he can save everyone from getting killed. AZ said, "Listen, man, there's no money in this safe. I got about $150,000 in my crib in Jersey. Take me to the house and I'll get you the rest. Just don't hurt nobody." Kev started saying, "Yeah, man, don't play me like you did before. You did me wrong, man." AZ said, "Yo, Kevin, I didn't play you." Kevin said, "Yes, you did. Now get up. You can't leave like this. You got blood all over your face." AZ's whole plan to Jersey was just so he can get outside and make a run for it. He knew staying in that apartment, everyone was going to be dead. He figured if he can just get outside, he can probably save everybody. It was worth a try. Kevin and the other two cats thought about it. They was considering trying to make that run to Jersey. Now, Kevin started to freak out. What you looking at me like that for? You trying to play me again? I know there's some money in here. I know there's some money in here. As AZ was in the bathroom washing his face, getting the blood out of his eyes, someone turned the stereo up real loud, and he heard gunshots go off. AZ charged after Kevin and fought for his life. He almost got a hold of the gun until another cat came into the bathroom, pointed the gun right at his forehead, and pulled the trigger.
Some viewers may find the following video disturbing. Viewer discretion is advised.
By the time AZ opened his eyes, he found himself laying in a pool of his own blood. There was so much blood that he started to slip and stumble as he got up. He had to hold on to the sink just to pull himself up. Staggering to the bedroom to a sight that he would never forget. Everyone laid motionless, each shot in the head and left for dead. He shook Charlie first. Come on, man, get up. They're gone now. Please come back. Then he turned towards everyone else. Nobody responded. AZ laid in the bed and pulled the covers over his bloody body. At that moment, he just wanted to die. He tried his best to go to sleep. He woke up on a stretcher in Lincoln Hospital.
August 20th, 1987. That was the day I got shot. And he had to go down like that, you know what I mean? Being honest. You know, stick up, robbery. And shot like five people. I lived through it, but I got shot in the head twice, you know? Got shot here, got shot here, got shot in the neck, the shoulder, hand, shot all up in the leg, and shot three times in the leg. My leg was broke in like three different spots. Lost my sense of smell. I can't smell to this day from the gunshot wound. But lucky, you know, to God, you know, praise God, and I'm still here able to talk to you right now about it.
This is the 10 o'clock news.
Welcome back. The streets of the Bronx are a lot safer tonight.
That's right, Rosanna, because two vicious killers are in jail for life. You're about to see the judge throw the book at them, but not before they made one last defiant stand.
It was a humid August night outside along the Grand Concourse as the three killers silently crept up three flights of stairs, then down this hallway to this corner apartment. Once they pushed their way inside, they rounded up six friends, one of them a 13-year-old girl. They shoved them back into a rear bedroom, made them lie on the floor, and then pumped 25 shots into the backs of their heads and bodies.
It was a crazy night, man. And to live through it and to still be sane, to me, it's like, I gotta praise God, man. You know, every step I take through life from this point on, because I know it was him that was there with me. It's crazy to see someone put the gun on your forehead and you watch them pull the trigger. I braced myself to take a bullet, not a punch, but to take a bullet. That embrace was so deep that God, like, I didn't even feel the gunshot wounds. I left. But the body must have stayed there and he must have kept shooting the body up. But I was gone already, bro. You know what I mean? And I was in the light. And it was up to me if I wanted to live or not. And I asked God to let me live. And as a result, I'm here right now, you know what I mean? But it was a crazy night. It's a night that I don't really want to speak on.
The New York Times headline read, "Bloodbath in the Bronx. 5 Left 4 Dead. Around 1990, Rich found himself with a mountain of problems. He sat down and had a long conversation with AZ and his Benz one day. Rich was just tired of hustling. Rich said, "I'm taking too many losses, eh?" He told him, he let his friend Black Just from Queens borrow his Porsche. Police pulled it over, seized Rich's car, and said that they're keeping it forever. Rich said, "My little chick from the projects is under investigation. That Porsche is in her name, and she's scared to death. I don't know what to do." Rich told AZ about a plan to move to Florida. He said, "Harlem, this is no place to live, man. I don't want my family growing up around this no more." Rich believed Katz was jealous of him and was trying to get him. Rich said, "I don't want to be in this forever. I need to slow down." AZ said Rich's mind was racing 100 miles an hour with no brakes. "Yo, A, you're not gonna believe this one. The cops pulled me over while I was driving my cousin's Nissan Maxima. I had 40 grand cash on me. They took all my information, gave me a voucher slip for the cash, and told me that I can get it back when I can prove to them where I got the money from." AZ said, "Yeah, man, it seems like they own you. You're gonna have to chill." Rich said, "Man, the other day they ran up in one of my stash houses and found like 100 grand in singles. Lucky for me, nobody was in there." Rich said, "Man, my mom gets high. I don't want Donnell to be around this. He can play ball real good, you know. Him and my nephew Trav. Maybe they can make it to the NBA, who knows? I got 2 kids on the way by 2 different girls." Around this time, Rich started mentally and emotionally spiraling out of control. Rich had admitted to AZ that he got one of his buddy's little brother killed because of his disrespectful conduct with crack fiends. Rich had a dark cloud over him. He was stressed, and a lot of heavy stuff was on his mind. And shortly after that is when his brother got kidnapped. Anybody with an ounce of morality can't hear these words that I'm about to read and not feel something behind it. What I'm about to repeat are the words from young Donnell Porter. "Mommy, I don't want to die. Please help. Tell Richard to give them the money. Mommy, I love you. Tell Pat I love her too. Help me. Mommy, please don't let them kill me. They cut my finger off. Mommy, it hurts real bad. And it won't stop bleeding. Help me, please." And the thing that makes this just that much more devastating is the fact that his own uncle was the mastermind behind all this. But this is the game. The game is sick, it's unfair, and this is what it do to you. Alpo destroyed many families. Alpo killed and assisted in killing many people. Alpo did 25 years. He got out, enjoyed about 5 or 6 years of freedom, and then he was killed.
So this notorious drug lord, Alpo Martinez, shot and killed on the streets of Harlem. He was a larger-than-life figure who seemed to defy death. Fox 5's Lisa Evers goes over who he was and why he might have had a long list of enemies.
He was one of the city's most notorious drug dealers, famous since the 1980s for his murderous ways and mountains of cash and drugs, immortalized in dozens of rap songs and the movie Paid in Full. But it all came to an end for Alpo Martinez right here on the streets of Harlem, right where it all began. These are exclusive photos of Alberto Alpo Martinez on previous visits to Harlem in recent years. But his latest visit turned out to be his last. On Sunday, about 3:20 a.m., police were called to Frederick Douglass Boulevard near West 147th Street. A dark red pickup truck crashed into parked cars. The driver was shot 5 times in the chest through the car window and killed.
I heard 5 shots, one and then four consecutive shots after that.
It was Alpo, but his driver's license and other IDs had his witness protection name of Abraham Rodriguez with a Lewiston, Maine address. The murder scene stretched for blocks up to 151st Street. Alpo had been given a new identity when he was released from a Colorado supermax prison in 2015 after serving more than 20 years for 14 murders. But instead of lying low, he couldn't seem to stay away from New York.
He's been seen riding around Harlem most of the time.
Police have arrested the man they say murdered former Harlem drug lord Albert Alpo Martinez. Cops arrested Shaquem Parker. He's 27 years old. He was already being held on Rikers Island in a gun case. Police say he also has priors for burglary, robbery, and drug possession. Mr. Martinez was gunned down in October of last year while in a car on Frederick Douglass Boulevard near West 152nd Street.
So again, when you look at Rich Azy and Alpo, what did they get out of all this? Watching, make sure you hit the thumbs up. Make sure you subscribe. Let me know what you think in the comment section. Please follow the History with No Chaser Facebook and Instagram pages.